Ethos Decorum.
Internets, what's going on? It's your boy, Uncle Sneaker, aka God Boot God, aka, well, let me just tell you my name, Dallas Penn, here in New York City. New York, concrete jungle, weird dream. All right, I'm talking crazy. Right now, we're on Delancey Street. This is the iconic New York City strip for getting fresh. Come down here, cop your kicks. Come down here, cop your leather jacket. Come down here and just intermingle with people from the Bronx, Harlem, Brooklyn, Queens. Get to see what the lifestyle is. Get to see how people put their presentations and fits together. But here in the new New York, Delancey Street is not like it used to be. But there's still some little vestiges, some little cubby holes of old New York. I know some of them. Let's go take a visit with me right now. John, we are here at one of the classic, iconic New York City mom pops. Really one of the last of the last. Just a handful of them left. This spot, Richie's, man, you might be able to find a sneaker here at retail price that dropped 1, 2, even 3 years ago. I mean, that's what was on this strip. That was New York City all over. Mom and pops kind of, you know, they held their inventory until they sold through it.
Gotcha.
Know, it'd go down on clearance, it'd get reduced, but they basically had to sell through of their inventory.
Gotcha.
You know, now in the city, man, we're dealing with mostly Foot Lockers and Champs and Finish Lines, and we're dealing with big box stores, so it's like whatever these manufacturers want to push on us. That's what we're getting now.
Gotcha.
So this is one of my spots that I come to, and I like to see, man, listen, can I find something that I might have missed from last year or 2 years ago? And they still got it in my size, and they got it at the price I want to pay.
Okay, let's check out Richie's.
All right, bet. Okay. Flavors on flavors on flavors of Air Max. Ethos Decorum, you messing with this Air Max 270? This is like the Air Force 270 shoe right here. I messes with this shoe. Got that nice little safari print right in there popping. What you think? What you think, John?
I think it's different. I still got to get used to it, but I like sneakers with kind of like the strap.
Yeah.
This actually reminds me of all the early 90s Huaraches type strapping system.
Yes.
So that's good. I haven't tried it out yet as far as the technology and the comfort, but yeah, I kind of like the straps and the safari. You can't go wrong with
Safari. You can't go wrong with any kind of print. Elephant print, safari print. What I love about these air bubbles is that the larger they get, we're at the point now where Nike is charging me for nothing. That used to be rubber right here. That used to be a material. And now it's air.
Gotcha.
One day I'm gonna open up a box of Nike Air, ain't gonna be nothing in that box.
Gotcha.
But air.
Gotcha.
You know what Nike Air smells like? It smells like Northwest Redwoods.
Gotcha.
And Tinker Hatfield farts. Let's talk about Nike's VaporMax. All right, again, man, look at this, giving me more and more air. I remember my first pair of shoes that I went crazy for to buy was a pair of blue suede Puma. And just the idea of having a suede shoe was just so incredible to me. And I look at shoes now and they're entirely synthetic. There's no leather here, there's no man-made. It's all man-made, rather, all right? This fly-knit upper, you know, this molded plastic air bubble platform. Like, wow, it's incredible, man. And 30 years ago, all I wanted was a suede shoe. Now all I want is a shoe that's knit by my grandmother. Ah, so this is really where I wanted to be right here. All right, I'm an old head, so I'm still messing with these J's heavy, okay? Did you catch this French blue 7 right here? I missed this one. I missed it. Let me see. Oh, snap, he got it in size 12, too. Oh, snap, let me find out. I missed this shoe. But
what's your favorite Jordan of all time?
Favorite Jordan of all time is a 6 model.
Okay.
okay. You know, so I like sixes. I like sixes, and however they mock them up, whatever, however they color them up. I mean, the black infrared six is undeniable.
Yes.
He won his first championship in that shoe. All right. And as a New Yorker, I couldn't embrace Jordan until he won his first championship, because he was always going through my Knicks to get to that point.
Gotcha.
So I had to finally salute him, and once he finally won it, got through New York, got through Detroit, he was wearing a six, gotcha. Six shoe. All kind of joints, though. All kind of joints, man. You might have missed, and Richie's has it, man. This was the benefit of the mom and pop store, that they kept this merchandise until they sold through it. And I mean, you might have missed it. I mean, first of all, we didn't grow up rich. And I didn't grow up able to access every release when Nike released it. All right, sometimes I had to wait a month. Sometimes, you know, you getting your paper out money up, you getting your allowance money up, you getting your bread up from your side job, from your after school job.
Gotcha.
You're not ready at the release date to pay. You ready when you got that money.
Gotcha.
So mom and pop shops helped you get fresh after the fact. And I'll tell you what, let me tell you why it's fly to get fresh after the fact. Everybody that wore their shoe on release day, by the time you get yours a month later, 2 months later, their joints is all scuffed up. And when you get your joint together, you put your whole fit together. So you're not just walking around with a white tee and new J's, you're walking around with a whole outfit built and architected around that shoe. Ethos Decorum, I got y'all right now at Orchard Street. This is the iconic shopping strip here in New York City. This is the melting pot for the boroughs. Brooklyn, Bronx, Queens, even Staten Island. Came up here on Orchard Street and you copped the leather, you copped a pair of kicks. But the best part was you could talk with the dealer and wiggle and haggle a price a little bit. You know what I mean? Let's say you didn't have, you know, the $100, you had 85. You know, you just say, take your money out, show that 85, and then after you was walking out, they bring you back in. You know, also, this is for New York City. This was a classic Jewish-owned shopping strip. And there was a time when I feel like with those shop owners, they understood their clientele to the point where it was like, you know, they knew, they recognized you. They saw you visit their stores. They watched you. And they knew you. So that they knew, oh, you come to me several times. Here, let me give you a deal.
So they build a relationship.
Absolutely.
Definitely build a relationship.
Absolutely. I mean, that's what the mom and pop shop was. It was a relationship. It was someone that you trusted. You know what I mean? They didn't mind putting their shoes aside for you when they know you got up, when you was liquid. And, you know, and then they gave you a little, you know, disco, depending on how often, like, you know, you came and you visited. Relationship status. Now, man, everything is behind the glass wall, man. It's like, you know, what have you done for me lately kind of stuff. I can't act like that. It's not totally like that. I mean, I do have relationships out here. And that's part of the reason why I still kind of move the way I do. But the culture of that is disappearing. Man, right here on Orchard Street, this is the classic New York shopping strip. But here in the new New York, man, it ain't like it used to be. But there's still one spot holding it down. Hopefully some more spots is gonna open up. The one spot holding it down is Extra Butter. All right, official sneaker shop, official swag shop. Not just kicks, but for apparel, for lifestyle, for putting your whole outfits together, you gotta fall through Extra Butter. John, man, this sneaker right here changed lives. The idea that you could look through a sneaker. This Air Max 1 is still, for me, I mean, we say iconic all throughout the show today, but this is an icon right here. An absolute icon.
You cannot lose with an Air Max 1.
No, you cannot. Air Max 1, Air Max 87, whatever you want to call it fresh. Like I said, just the idea, that looking glass. We looked into the looking glass right there. And you know what we saw on the other side? The future. Air Max 1. So Extra Butter is not simply a general release sneaker shop. They're getting special product from sportswear dealers like Nike, like New Balance. you're gonna get some what used to be called Tier Zero product, which was Quick Strike, or just really limited production Nike product. And I mean, Extra Butter just does a great job in presenting it and giving you a space to come and consume it. That's beautiful, it's bright, it's well lit, it's just, you know, it makes you want to cop a pair of shoes.
Presentation is the key.
Absolutely.
Let's talk about how you feel about sportswear brands and designers kind of merging and where you think that's going.
Well, what's funny about sportswear brands finally taking on high-end luxury designers is for the longest time, brands like Nike fought against the lifestyle categorization of their product. They said, oh, our shoes are for sport and sport only. And I don't know why they were living in such denial, because I mean, there's no way you're selling as many shoes as you are, and our country is obese as it is, and people are wearing them for sport. Obviously, these things had become markers of fashion. So, I mean, it was inevitable that it would happen, that high-end would find its way down here. Now, let's keep in mind something. I go back to collecting sneakers when the most technology was put into a tennis shoe. And you would have shoes worn by Yannick Noah, by Bjorn Borg, by Arthur Ashe, great tennis players, and they had the best technology in them, the best materials on them, you know, incredible leathers, just incredible builds. Then the technology went into basketball shoes, you know, with the advent of the Air Jordan and just the fact that basketball shoes drove the market. Now I'm happy that runners are kind of getting the attention, or lifestyle shoes now are getting the attention that tennis shoes and basketball shoes once got. They're getting the design elements, they're getting the technological fabrics. So, I mean, it's exciting.
Now, a question I have for you is, a lot of designers are focusing on their own sneakers. Before, it was mostly like the Prada sneakers that was the standard, that it was a designer sneaker that regular people on the street were wearing as a regular sneaker. The Prada sneaker is one of the only few ones. And before that, maybe the Gucci sneakers in a selective way. Now designers are really putting a lot of money into their own sneaker. Do you see designers kind of giving a run for their money with the sportswear brands, or the sportswear brands too big to fail?
The sportswear brands are too big to fail. And two, I think the high-end luxury designer sneaker, they ebb and flow. And the Gucci trainer, man, had its height in the 80s. And then it dropped off. I mean, it's not simply, you can be attractive to the consumer with a high-end product for but so long. And at a certain point, it's got to be comfortable. It's got to have the utilitarian necessities that this shoe has. It's supposed to have. Is this shoe a good runner? Probably not. All right? And ultimately, that's why the designer shoes will fail. People will be like, you know what? I don't need a $600 pair of sneakers. I need a good running sneaker. And, oh, I can get it for $100.
So maybe the blend between designer and sportswear collaborations like these, maybe that's the happy medium, to where you get a little bit of that technology, that history of sportswear mixed with the designer, and it's not just all designer.
I think it ebbs and flows. It'll come and it'll go.
Okay.
And I think we're seeing the tremendous trend right now, just because we've got this focus on brands like Louis, like Margiela, like Balenciaga. But as soon as we kind of take our eyes off of that, because our trend moves us somewhere else, we'll stop seeing those collaborations. I mean, I enjoy it, but I don't see it as being long-lasting.
And speaking of Margiela, this is the basis for probably a most popular sneaker, which is an OG Adidas running sneaker. So, like you said, ebbs and flows and comes back.
Yep. Dope. Oh, and hey, listen, you know, New Balance. I really like these. I mean, just a simple shoe, a good, comfortable shoe, nice suede on it. Oh, made in the USA. All right. Beautiful summer colors, red, white, and blue. You know, red, gray, and blue. How can you go wrong with this?
Can't go wrong with New Balance.
I can't. I physically can't do any wrong with this suede here. I can't. I, 3M hits, all right, Scotch light hits to pop when the nighttime light hits me. What more do I need?
And it's comfortable. It's pure comfort. Pure comfort.
Uh-oh. Looking like I might have to get this. One of the sick things about extra butter that people would know, what made them like a real sick progressive shop, is that they do movie screenings inside the store. So like once a month, once every couple of months, they show a movie and they tie in a sneaker or they tie in some apparel for that movie. And it's a way of them kind of connecting the lines of culture and having the seamless blend of culture, of content, of movie, of what you're wearing, of what you're eating.
You know, so more than just fashion.
Absolutely.
This may have been your favorite movie growing up. You like the t-shirt, you see it, you come and watch the movie.
John, this is what I talk about, lifestyle. And lifestyle is not just how you present yourself, but it's the content that you let take in through your eyes, through your ears. It's the food that you take in, the nutrition you take in through your mouth. So lifestyle is a combination of all of these things. And it moves you forward. Listen, lifestyle allowed me to mess around with sushi. It allowed me to mess around with Thai food. It allowed me to mess around with Indian food and try food from different cultures. And just like hip-hop is this remix culture, it's allowed people from other places to present themselves like I like to look. So it's just great sharing. Man, people say, oh my God, the internet has been the death of culture. It really hasn't. The internet has been the birth of this brand new culture of sharing and information passing.
So Dallas, it seems like Nike's back with ACG. What do you think about the new ACG? I'm feeling it, what do you think?
What do I think about the new ACG? I love it because it's like the old ACG. And one of the great things Nike gave us, other than some fantastic sneaker silhouettes, was their dramatic use of color. And I feel like Nike was just fearless with their use of neons, with their use of just like, you know, off palette colors. And I'm seeing it right here. This is it. This is it. I love this. I miss this. I mean, look at these neons. Look at these teals. Where do you get this kind of color? Where do you get the nerve to wear these kinds of colors? You know, and Nike made these color blockings, these blends, a staple now for us. Now, nobody feels a kind of way about wearing fuchsia. It's like, why not? I can do that. I'm confident in myself. I'm confident in my presentation. I could go out like this. I'm so confident in my presentation, I could go out in some poom poom shots. These are what you call poom poom shots. Why? Because your poom poom. Your poom poom show when you wear poom poom shot. Okay?
So Dallas, we're talking about building the architect outfit.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about starting with the footwear. We talked about, the pants, t-shirts. We talked about t-shirts. What are some of your favorite t-shirts of all time?
When it comes to tees, I mean, like I said, I have hundreds and hundreds of tees unworn. I go back to some of my great, I have a great Do the Right Thing, from the Do the Right Thing era, Nike basketball tee. And it's just color blocked in red, yellow, blue, green. And it went with a particular Nike shoe called the Air Raid, the Peace Raid. And so I love that tee, and it's 20 something years old and I keep it in good condition. I loved Ocean Pacific t-shirts. Ocean Pacific was one of the early, I mean, there was no such thing as streetwear, but they were coming out of California and they were hitting with city kids because they used fire graphics, fire silkscreen graphics, and they just were swaggy. Then from Ocean Pacific, I got into Stussy tees, heavy. I probably never went as hard for tees as I did with the Stussy tees.
Stussy had a great collection. They continue to have a great collection of tees over the decades.
Absolutely. Stussy is the greatest streetwear brand of all time. I put them, I mean, Supreme is certainly maybe the hottest streetwear brand that we've ever known, but Stussy's originality and their creativity is really what made them so great.
And their longevity.
Yes, yes.
They may not always be the hottest at the time.
But they're still doing good.
They still do what they do all the time.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. They still do good work, and they're still out there. So definitely salutes to Stussy. And now, right now, man, I'm just filled and filled and filled with Polo Ralph Lauren tees. Really good ones, though. Really ones that have embroidery on them, ones that have patches on them, or maybe a sash print, but definitely, oh, and ones that have bears on them. The bear tee has never been hotter for the Ralph Lauren brand than it is right now. It really, like, that signifies Polo Ralph Lauren to a lot of people. You'll see at the barbecues and the cookouts this summer, people rocking Polo bear tees.
How did you get into Polo? How did you get into Ralph Lauren Polo?
I got into Polo just because it was just the hottest thing going. And like many things, it ebbs and flows, but what Polo was able to do for me when I was a teenager was it was able to give me a swag presentation. And then as I got older, it was able to mature with the things that I wanted to do. It was able to give me an outdoorsy presentation when I wanted to go hiking, when I wanted to go camping, when I wanted to do some kind of athletic activity. It was there. It was there for those types of things, mountain biking. So Polo really, to me, matches lifestyle and whatever activity you want to get into within your lifestyle. Polo's got a setup for you. They've got a collection for you to rock so that you can really maximize your lifestyle. You want to go mountain biking, man. They've got these beautiful RLX jackets that have pockets, that have hooks, that have, you know, that have things to help you get your mountain bike going. You want to go hunting. You want to go quail hunting. Get a quail hunting jacket. It's got a shooting patch on the shoulder. It's got a stow pocket in the back, so you can put your game, you can put your quail that you've shot. So its design is so true to these activities. Ralph Lauren made sure that they went and looked at the barber items or the belt staff jackets or whatever people use to be authentic to these activities, and they copied them exactly and specifically for their item. Here we are up in Harlem at this spot called Jan's NYC. Matter of fact, I found these guys through Instagram. All right, the internet's undefeated, brother.
Undefeated.
All right, found this spot on Instagram and came up here, and I was like, oh, wow, you know, in the cut, a dope low spot in Harlem, not even in Brooklyn, in Harlem. And they don't just sell low here, man. They got all kind of streetwear brands and all kind of what I would consider aspirational apparel for a hood celebrity. Huh. but now here we go. Here's where I get in. Polo Ralph Lauren, bro. Here's where I get in. Oh, and Jan's even got a nice little rack. Nice little sale rack right here going on too. So you got the new stuff that's just circulating, that's just dropping. And then you got, you know, that sale rack swag right here. Okay? Get in where you fit in. Internet, that's one of the operative catchphrases I've always loved. Get in where you fit in. You know, if your pocket is fat, then live like that. If, you know, if you're working on a budget, that's all right. Do that too. You know, get in where you fit in. Ralph Lauren really bringing back that Americana iconography. That Americana iconography. I don't even know if I'm pronouncing that right, but y'all know what I mean when you see a flag and an eagle. You know, that means the classic American spirit. Man, that is what Polo has based their whole shit on, their whole steez on, is being this classic American brand. Ethos Decorum, thank you for hanging out with your boy, Uncle Sneaker. God Move God, Dallas Penn, today as I ran through New York City looking for the mom and pop shops that had that deal, that special deal that was too real to not take advantage of. Shouts to my folks here at Jan's NYC. And you, the viewer of Ethos Decorum.